Hey everyone.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi. Oh, this is so exciting. I'm so excited that you're all here. And that this event's come together with so many beautiful faces. All the faces that I can see and all the ones that I can't quite see because of Zoom and pandemic and I'm Veronica Santiago Liu. I'm the founder and general coordinator of Word Up Community Bookshop, Libreria Comunitaria, which is one of the three hosting bookstores today. Before we get into introductions, I have some Zoom keeping. For the attendees, at the bottom of your screens, you'll see a box, like a button for Q&A, and we'll be taking the questions for authors later when Lupita opens it up for Q&A, just through that Q&A box. So if you have any questions, don't put it in the chat because it's this running feed that, you know, the questions will get lost. Just put them into the Q&A and Carolina Valencia from Word Up will sweep through and, you know, make sure that things are organized there. Feel free to use the chat though, so you can all, you know, you can chat with the panelists, you can chat with each other, you can just emote all you want and just share your excitement about this event, that's totally fine. So we're leaving the chat up for that. Thank you to Emmanuel, DJ Boy Abreu from Word Up for the DJing earlier. And what else? So an overview of the evening is, each of the bookstores will get to say hello. We'll introduce the authors and then Lupita will take it from there. And then we'll have a Q&A at the end. So stay tuned for all of that. We're really happy that you're all here in support of authors, in support of new books, in support of brick and mortar bookstores. All of us are challenged in this time and also in support of each other and just being here as part of this community gathering. That is a different kind of gathering than we're all used to, us bookstore lovers. As I mentioned, just a quick introduction to Word Up. After the pandemic, you can find us at 2113 Amsterdam Avenue at the corner of 165th Street and Washington Heights. Though for now, you can check us out at wordupbooks.com or follow us at Word Up Books. To see what we have going on. We have a couple of big events on the horizon, so and we'll probably announce in the next couple of days, so stay tuned for that. We opened in 2011 as a pop-up shop that was supposed to just last for 1 month, but there was so much community support for the space that we are on the verge of our 9th birthday, which is a really big deal for a place that was so temporary and, you know, built on love and like no money. we're also a nonprofit and we operate as a collective comprised of a tiny staff and around 60 active volunteers. We're really glad to be here with all of you. The bookstores that we wanted to, you know, we have all pulled together to make this happen, are also community spaces, in their own boroughs, in their own neighborhoods, in their own spots. So before we introduce the authors and moderator, I want to pass the mic to the other bookstores who've been partners in this event, the Lit Bar in the Bronx and Mil Mundos Books and Cafe in Brooklyn. So first, let's have Noel Santos, founder and proprietress of the Lit Bar.
Hey, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. The host unmuted me. How you doing? I'm Noel Santos from the Bronx, and I own the Lit Bar. the Lit Bar is a bookstore wine bar. We opened in 5 days will be our 1 year anniversary. We're a bookstore, we're a wine bar. We have books for all ages and we host a lot of dope authors, many of who are being featured tonight. I'm so excited to be here. Veronica, is there anything you wanted me to like touch up upon? Specifically,
how can people support you in this time?
One, being here, thank you so much. And then our bookshop, so we've partnered with bookshop.org because I couldn't handle fulfillment in the store and keep my team safe. So they're handling all our fulfillment. So if you go to bookshop.org, just hit shop from, I'll put in the links somewhere. The same place you bought these books from, go there. And you can shop books and have them shipped to you. And I can't wait to see you when we're on the other side of this. Cheers.
Cheers.
All right, and so we have Sarita, I think is, I just moved over to this room, and let us know a little bit about Mil Mundos.
Hi, sorry, we're a little late. Maria's off celebrating her mom's birthday, but I'm Sarita, the publicist from Mil Mundos Bookstore. Thank you so much. It's the first time I've danced in a really long time, so I'm very excited tonight. Thank you so much for this amazing opportunity. I love every author that's there, and I'm grateful for the space and the opportunity for tonight.
Thanks. And I also wanted to give a shout out to, I know there's so many familiar names and, you know, wish I could see the faces of the attendees. And I know among them is Angela Maria Spring, who's the owner of Duende District Bookstore in the DC area in Albuquerque. And, you know, she's one of the inaugural members of the diversity task force of the American Book Sales Association, so that doing all kinds of work on that end. So I just wanted to say hey, and that we have also another event on the horizon with her on representation in bookstores in the literary field that she'll be moderating. So we're looking forward to that too. Okay, giving credit where credit is due, I want to thank first Angie Cruz, the author here with us, who besides being a novelist and editor and publisher of the literary journal Asterisk, is a great neighbor and organizer. This multifaceted event supporting so many different things, authors, new books, most of all brick and mortar bookstores, community spaces, all of them, is her brainchild. Angie's novel, Dominicana, released last September, was our inaugural pick for our Uptown Reads program in Washington Heights and Inwood. Then Good Morning America copied us and made it their inaugural pick too for their book club. Dominicana will be released in Espanol, translated by a fellow Dominicana, Kiani Antiga, next year, which is very exciting. And she's also the author of Soledad and Let It Rain Coffee. Carolina de Robertas is the author of the novels Cantoras, winner of a Stonewall Book Award and a Reading Women Award, The Gods of Tango, winner of a Stonewall Book Award, Perla, and the international bestseller, The Invisible Mountain. Jaquira Diaz, I don't know where everyone's placed on your screens, I know, so I keep pointing to people in my Zoom world here, but they might be a different, completely different place for you. Jaquira was born in Puerto Rico and raised in Miami. She's the author of Ordinary Girls, a memoir, very recent winner of a Whiting Award and Florida Book Awards Gold Medal and a Lambda Literary Awards finalist. Lilian Rivera is an award-winning author of the young adult novels Dealing in Dreams and The Education of Margot Sanchez, and the forthcoming middle grade novel Goldie Vance, The Hotel Whodunit, and Never Look Back. Born in Lima, Peru, and raised in Brooklyn, Melissa Vivero is the author of The Affairs of the Falcons, which won the New American Voices Award and was nominated for the Penn Hemingway Debut Novel Prize, the Aspen Words Literary Prize, and the Center for Fiction's First Novel Prize. Natalia Sylvester is the author of Chasing the Sun, and Everyone Knows You Go Home, which won an International Latino Book Award and several other awards. And her debut YA, Running, is forthcoming in July 2020. And last but not least, this introduction to our moderator, Lupita Aquino, better known as Lupita Reads, is the co-founder and moderator of the Lit on H Street Book Club hosted at Solid State Books in DC, and is a passionate reader active in both the local and online book community through her Instagram blog at Lupita Reads. She's also a columnist for the Washington Independent Review of Books and a contributor for the Reading Women podcast. Thank you, Lupita, and thank you everyone for being here. Lupita, take it away.
Wow. What a lineup. Can we just talk about that first of all? I mean, seriously, it's It's just an honor to be among everybody here, and just to see all your lovely faces. Everyone looks so great. And as Veronica mentioned, you know, I'm just going to ask a few questions and then we're going to open it up to the readers, because I know that readers like me have so many questions for you guys, because they've been touched by your books and they've been loving your books for a while. So I just want to kick it off with Angie. You know, it's been a pleasure to, I'm so excited to chat with you again. You know, we actually got to do something in person before all of this happened at Solid State Books. And, you know, something that stuck with me when we met in person was your Instagram archive. And I know it's interesting because you have an Instagram archive that you created for Dominicanas. And I was wondering if you could tell us about why you created it and if it has any ties to your novel, Dominicana.
First of all, I'm so overwhelmed with emotion. I actually don't, I'm so excited to be here. I'm so excited. I see the list of all the people that are here and it's so amazing. More than I could imagine that could have happened here. So thank you, Lupita, everyone, Veronica, everyone for, and all of you to be here. It's just so fun. But the archive, yeah. So when it took me a number of years to pull this book together. And one of the things I did was look through people's family albums to get the history that of Dominicans in 1960s that I couldn't find in the official archives. And I realized that in looking through people's albums and them being given the opportunity to tell their stories, I was also validating that experience or affirming that experience, but also it was so joyous, right? So when my book came out and I was thinking about Dominicana felt like such a big name for such what felt like a singular story. And I wanted to create, a sense of that this, she's Dominicana, but she's this Dominicana, there's many Dominicanas, right? That came and had arrival stories. And I wanted to, complicate that story, right? Like we read the book Dominicana and I wanted the archive to complicate the vast, diverse, incredible community of women from the 50s through the 80s that came to New York City. But more than anything, I started the Instagram because it was joyous. Like people have been finding each other through the Instagram. I have found family members through the Instagram that I had never
met before.
So if there's anyone out there who has any photographs of Dominicanas between the 50s and now I've extended to the 90s because so many people wanted to be included in the Instagram archive, please send them to me. It's ongoing and it keeps growing. And again, it's a way to have another kind of conversation around what does it mean to arrive, labor, and a lot of these stories are not in the official archive. So it's kind of creating a living museum of this community that I care about so much.
Yeah and I mean, it's gorgeous. And I don't know if anyone's checked it out. Did you drop the handle in case? I mean, we can put it in the.
Yeah, you should check it out.
Yeah, and I love the way that for me, when I read your book, Dominicana, I read it and then I went to the Instagram and it, like you said, it continued the stories of Dominicanas in New York City.
Yeah. And a lot of people say, what happened to Anna? And I say, yeah. Instagram, there's so many possibilities, you know? So, yeah.
There's so many different Annas.
Yeah.
So no, I love that. And I'm like really excited because I know that we're going to talk to Carolina. And I know that me and you connected over her book, Cantoras, initially, which is, I think, super cool when you connect with an author about another author's book. So, you know, I'm just going to ask Carolina, you know, I read the first 10 pages of Cantoras and like, I knew immediately I was going to love it. You know, I was like, I'm setting this down. I'm going to Instagram. I'm going to Twitter. I'm going to tell everybody this is like the book. But I didn't tell anybody what the book was about, you know? And so I had somebody like, tell me like, hey, like, I just learned what the meaning of cantoras is. It's not actually, it doesn't actually mean singing in Spanish. So I was wondering if you could tell us about the title and the ways in which these women, Romina Flaca, Anita Lavines, Blasa and Malenia, each find their own voice by being part of a chosen family they found in each other.
Yes. Yes, thank you so much for that question. And just the three bookstores, you are incredible. Lupita, it's such an honor to be here with you. And I am a straight up fan of all the other writers in the Zoom room. So thank you all for being here with us. And we love you all, everyone who's here listening. So thank you. Such a joy to be part of this incredible virtual fiesta. In terms of Cantoras, this most recent novel of mine, my fourth, the title actually came towards the end as a title for the book, but the word had always been part of it because this book grew out of my own listening to women a generation older than me in Uruguay. I had started going back in my mid-20s, just as a young queer woman in the Uruguayan diaspora, just looking for signs of queer life and some kind of mirroring, and to kind of break the narrative that I couldn't be both queer and Uruguayan at the same time. That was causing me a lot of pain. And I found this group of women who had found each other during the dictatorship in the late 70s, and who created this crew and made a real refuge for themselves, both on a far-flung beach and in the city. And I was so inspired by them. I really listened to their stories for 18 years. And some of them are very dear friends. And then I went back to them years later and kind of asked their blessing to write a story from their lives. And this crew of women and a couple of other related crews during the dictatorship used the word cantora as code for lesbian. So it's an old-fashioned word for lesbian. It's an old-fashioned word rather for singer. Like, we also have the word cantante. But they started saying cantora, like, hey, do you think she's a cantora? Like, does she sing? And so there's a double meaning there and a lot of layers of meaning, you know, and some of them are maybe a little racy. But there's also these other layers of meaning that I kept thinking about as I wrote them into being and wrote about these women who called themselves cantoras, and this was the language that they had for their world, that it also means, what does it mean to be a woman who sings? What does it mean to be a woman who uses your voice to take up space? And, you know, these women living with not only intense homophobia, but also the repression of a dictatorship and in authoritarian times, like what it took for them to live their authentic selves and to use their voices was something that was resonating for me in ways that I think are true for many of us today in many different ways. So it's about voicing, and yes, by building community and chosen family, which is something that I think queer communities have always done, and in Latino America and in Latinx communities, we've always done. Mm-hmm. We've always had it. We've always existed, but our stories haven't always had voice. Our stories haven't been able to always sing and become part of the texture of the greater culture or part of the printed page or literary world. I wanted to create more space for that.
Yeah, no, and for me, I mean, you did it. I think one of the most powerful things in the first few pages that I felt was to be Latina and to be queer, which is something that, you know, I just had never really experienced before, to just really be able to be like, you know, somebody who was queer and Latina. I don't even know how to explain it, but I mean, for me, it's just, it resonates in that sense. And I love that you talk about chosen families. And I love this combo because there's so many themes that kind of overlap. And I know that in Jakira's book, Ordinary Girls, she talks about her girls, you know, and I actually had a good friend of mine, Johanka Delgado, who interviewed Jakira for Electric Lit when Ordinary Girls first came out. And it was probably one of my favorite interviews because it felt so honest and open, just like your memoir. And, you know, in it, you mentioned that you define Ordinary Girls, the title changed for you while you were writing the book, or the definition of it. So could you tell us about how the definition evolved for you as the book progresses, and how were you able to reflect and write hard truths from your past?
Thank you so much for that question, and thank you all for being here. This has been so uplifting and necessary for me, looking forward to this event, especially now. So thank you. About the title, I had the concept of the title before I really had the language for it, before the words. And I was thinking about growing up and how growing up as a Puerto Rican woman, as a Puerto Rican girl and woman, especially coming from a Black Puerto Rican family, how often that meant for me that I felt both invisible and hypervisible, depending on who I was with, depending on the people in my community, depending on who was in power and where I was, whether I was in Puerto Rico or in the United States, and how that was always changing for me. Still, the conversation about race in Puerto Rico is very complicated, especially when, depending on where you are. Like if you're in El Caserío, people are often marginalized more than people who are not in El Caserío, obviously, because we come from poverty. Mm-hmm. And then there's a whole history of how people ended up in caseríos and how Black people were marginalized and forced to be basically in communities that were stricken by poverty and stuck in a cycle and not able to get there. And there are systems in place that make it impossible for you to get out. And so for me, part of the title was kind of reflecting on, was meant to get the readers to think about what it meant to want to be an ordinary girl, to be invisible at times, but then at times to be seen, to actually be seen by people outside of my community, by people inside my community, people in my own family, for who I actually was. And sometimes the title just meant being seen as a girl. Something that happens to Black and brown girls is that they're often criminalized and hypersexualized and treated like they're women, even when they're just girls. And the dominant culture, people in positions of power tend to look at Black and brown girls as women. And they're arrested when they're in elementary school, when they're 6 years old. Mm-hmm. And so my title was really meant to get people to think about this idea that being an ordinary girl for some of us is just like getting you to see us as a girl when we're 6 years old rather than seeing us as a woman. Something that's not really in the book that I'm going to be writing about soon, I started it with an article that I wrote for The Guardian about how the school to prison pipeline is getting worse for Black and brown girls. Mm-hmm. And all the research, all of it shows that it's directly caused by how they're perceived and judged by people in power. Teachers, police officers, school administrators, and especially cops. And it has absolutely nothing to do with whether they're actually misbehaving. Girls are suspended from school just for having emotions when they're Black and brown. And so for me, that title felt like I knew what it was before I had the language for it. Mm. Throughout the book, I make references to the title. I make references to the phrase ordinary girl. And I really wanted the reader to think about what is considered ordinary, what is considered just like a normal girl in our society. And what it means for someone like me, a person who grew up in poverty and who was considered a juvenile delinquent, for me to see myself as not being ordinary, like for me to feel when I was a teenager, when I was a girl, like I was some sort of monster. About your other question, how I wrote about the truths, the uncomfortable or hard truths from my past, I had to think about what was most important for me. While writing this book, I was always thinking about the reader who sees herself in my work and how much I needed books about people like me when I was growing up. Girls who were queer and Latina, Puerto Rican, Black, who were living in poverty or from working class communities, going to public school. And I really wanted to write about how my community was real without losing sight of what mattered most, that all these people that I was writing about are real, that they exist, that they live and love, even if the rest of the world didn't see them. And so I needed to always think about the reality, like for me, who I was, who I am, and never lose sight of the fact that I was writing not just about people, but for them. And that kept me focused. That kept me, it kept me accountable, knowing who I was writing for.
No, thank you for that. I think one of the things that I loved about the interview was the fact that you acknowledged that it was hard for you to face the truths, right, in writing them. And I just kept thinking about that in terms of ever writing myself, and in terms of what writers do sometimes, you know, even I think in fiction, we might put some of ourselves in it, which we might not have known. So thank you for that.
Thank you for the questions.
And, you know, I'm going to pivot to Lilium, Never Look Back. I am reading it now and I love it. And, you know, it struck me that it's a modern retelling of a Greek myth, the Orpheus and Eurydice myth. And I was just curious, what was it about the Greek myth that moved you to write a retelling of it? And not only that, to like set it in the Bronx with a main character that is mentally struggling with the aftermath of Hurricane Maria.
She's muted.
Can we get someone to unmute her?
Hi.
There you go.
Sorry about that. Hey, and I just thank you so much. And I just want to give a really big shout out to everyone in New York. My heart is in New York. I'm just like, my family's there, and it was really important to me to be a part of this. So I have all this love for you guys, and I'm always thinking, you know, thinking about you guys and praying for you and my family out there. So Never Look Back is a retelling of the Greek myth Orpheus and Eurydice, and it's the two characters. Main characters are a wannabe bachata singer, who's Theus, and Yuri, who's displaced Puerto Rican. She's displaced from Hurricane Maria. And the reason why I wrote this, the retelling, was because Hurricane Maria affected my family greatly. You know, I had family that was missing, you know, that we went online on social media just to try to locate them. And I wrote about it, and I was full of hopelessness. You know, I was really full of hopelessness, and I didn't know where to go because it was all rage and feeling like I couldn't do anything, and just looking at the way the government was reacting to it, and I didn't know where else to go. And the only place I can go when I'm in this spot is through fiction. So I needed a space. I needed like a structure that I could live, you know, I could live in. And I knew I could retell this Greek myth, which is one of my favorite myths. And so then I had the structure for the novel, and I was like, I could write about these two characters and what they're facing, and dealing with generational trauma, and kind of like trying to figure out where your place is in this world when you feel like you have no hope. And also, you know, when you're writing something, you don't realize that you realize when you take a step back what the book is really about, and then you start thinking, oh, this is an abusive relationship. And, you know, and I'm thinking about the islands and the U.S. and you know, all these kind of bigger themes that kind of pop up when I'm just thinking I'm writing a retelling. You know, this is a young adult book. And you start digging deeper and themes start to pop up. But it was really, ultimately, you know, it's really about hope. You know, the book is really about hope, and it's what I needed. And it's about hope and music and how music saves me in so many ways. And so, yeah, that was really what I wanted to do. I was like, how do I write this book? Because I am in such a dark place right now, and I needed fiction to save me in a lot of ways. So I feel like a lot of these books that all these authors write, save me again and again.
No, I love that you said that, because it makes me think of your first book, Margot, The Education of Margot Sanchez. And I remember reading it early on and just thinking, like, for the first time, being able to see a dysfunctional family, but also like this delicate balance between having respect for your father, who is someone that you love and that protects you and cares for you and has done so much and sacrifices so much. But then, you know, confronting with the fact that he's just human, you know, and he's gonna mess up and he's gonna let you down. So I love that about your books. So I know you say they're YA, but they're, I think, like you just said, I mean, books save us. And I felt like Margot definitely did that for me.
Thank you.
And another, you know, Melissa, I feel like The Affairs of Falcons, in my opinion, was a unique and necessary perspective about the undocumented experience in America. I was once undocumented. And I think what struck me the most was the fact that you included two major characters, Valeria and Mama, and those characters held their documentation status at a higher regard. And they used it to kind of prey on your main character, Ana, who was undocumented. And so I would really love to ask you about, you know, where the inspiration came from to write on us stories and the importance of including characters like Valeria and Mama. Oh, we need to unmute her.
Okay, can you hear
Perfect.
Me?
Yeah.
So the Anna story was inspired by something that actually happened to my mom, like early on when we first came to this country, and something happened to her. It was a relative of ours who caused this thing to happen to her, and she kept telling me the story as I was growing up, and then one day I just decided to sort of imagine what it would have been like to have been in her shoes. And so I wrote one scene, and Anna came from that scene, and Valeria came from that scene. So those were like the two, like, very strong people that came through. And I was just so curious about Anna and who she was, and I wanted to learn more about her story. So I sort of kept following the character, and I kept writing different scenes. And, you know, she was very much someone who was like my mother and like the women in her life. And as mean and as bad as Valeria and Mama are in the book, like, they were probably one of the more fun characters to write for me. And they have place in my heart.
That's so interesting. I love that, though.
Yeah, I mean, because I did try to make them somewhat sympathetic, but I don't know, some people really love them, or really hate to love, like, love to hate them, and others are like, oh yeah, I can kind of understand that they can feel some sort of compassion for them. But yeah, but I thought, I mean, for me growing up, getting a green card was always like the goal. Yeah. You know, it was always like your ticket to so many other things, an education or a job, or it was an entry into something, but it didn't always mean you were accepted into whatever it is that you were trying to get into, you know?
It was just like an illusion.
Yeah, totally. But you had these people that did have papers who would be like, hey, I can hook you up with some fake docs and a social security card, whatever. It's $2,000, $3,000, and it's like an exorbitant amount of money for someone who is, you know, undocumented. I mean, for a lot of people, but, you know, especially some people who are sort of in these situations where they feel like maybe they need it in order to get ahead and to stay. So because I remember all of that, I felt like I included in the story, because it would be natural for someone like Anna to have also people in her life that could prey on her, you know, even people from within her own community who you would expect her, you know, to be her support. So to answer your question, it was more of just like, I needed to stay true to the character and her story. I needed those people, like those people had to be in her life.
Yeah, no. And I mean, they exist. I think that's what struck me the most, is that it was so real. You know, I think anybody you talk to has a similar story in which they were taken advantage of, or their fear of, you know, being undocumented was held over them and used to manipulate them in some way.
Yeah. And it's, you know, it's funny because like when I started writing it about, you know, Anna and the people in her life, and the story started to take shape. It wasn't until I got to the end of the book, like when I had already sold it and was talking to editors about it, that they started asking me questions about why I wrote it. And I think only then did I sort of start to realize that, like, I don't think I ever quite got over the fear of like losing, of being separated from my parents.
Yeah.
And of all of the different ways that people could have separated us, you know?
Yeah.
And I think maybe like I knew that fear as a child. When I started writing the book, I wasn't a mother, and then by the time I finished, I was. And so then I understood it from a different perspective. From, like, really, I felt like I understood it from Anna's point of view. Like, in a way that maybe I didn't really get it when I first started, when I started that first scene. So even though it was fictionalized and it was something that, like, emerged from, like, the germ was something that had happened to my mom, like, in the end, it was sort of like I was trying to heal a wound that hadn't really healed ever.
Yeah, no, and that makes so much sense to me. No, it makes so much sense. Thank you. And so I'm going to just shift to Natalia. I finished your debut young adult novel a few days ago, and the characters have really still stuck with me. It honestly knocked me off my feet because, like, I never knew how starved I was for a story like Mari's, and specifically just the way she grapples with her political beliefs when they don't align with her father, who happens to be running for president. So can you talk about where the inspiration came from to write a story like Mari's, but specifically a character like Mari that's Cuban-American, Latina, her family's Latino, and he's running for president, you know, like, this is the dream, right? Oh, can we unmute her? There we go. You're back, yay.
Like, I muted myself earlier, but I can't unmute myself. That's the trick of it, I guess.
You're back.
Hi, thank you all. First of all, thanks for that question. And thank you all so much. I'm just like so excited and honored and thrilled to be here. This has been such a light in these days. And also Veronica, Noelle, and Sarita for being here. You know, we really can't do this without you all, so thank you. I started writing Running in July of 2016. No, was it 2016? Yeah, gosh, who knows now, right? No, it was actually during the election. And so I remember one morning I woke up, I was having breakfast. I kind of had the news on in the background, and there was a candidate for president making his concession speech. And I'll leave it to you to see who it was. So it was a Miami senator who was running for president. I couldn't stop, like, he's not someone I would have, like, you know, leaned over and with my cereal bowl just like fixated on, right? But his daughter was standing behind him in the background, and she had this look on her face that I just couldn't figure out. And I kept wondering, like, what is it like to be her, like, right now in this moment of in this moment of, this is a failure, you know, like, you, your father is conceding this huge, and this whole campaign must have completely consumed her life. But I also wondered, like, what is that? Like, what would it mean to have to witness that? Like, it's one thing to see our parents become human and full of flaws, right? Mm-hmm. It's another thing to have to see that as the whole world is watching. And so I started writing this book, and it really very quickly just came, like, Maddie's voice was just the very first thing. Like, I didn't know where it was going. I just knew, like, kind of like what she sounded like, how she felt, what her home looked like, how she felt in it. And I grew up in Miami. I've lived in Texas for the last 10 years or so, but I still have family there. So I'm there at least 3 times a year. And so it was just, it never occurred to me to write this book any other way. Because I think that when we talk a lot about, you know, writing like representation in books that represent marginalized communities, we're often talking about power. But I wanted to also talk about what happens when those who have power are not only oppressing the marginalized, but the people who are marginalized are also capable of further oppressing people in their own community, right? And so, and in Maddie's world, this happens in so many different ways. Like, she doesn't realize at first that, like, she's always supported her father kind of unquestioningly. Now that the spotlight is suddenly making her really uncomfortable, she has to come to terms with a lot of things she's learning about him. And in doing that, she ends up learning a lot about herself, because sometimes I think it's really fascinating the way that political identities are formed. And it is so personal, right? We forget how personal, we actually don't forget. A lot of people like to conveniently forget. I don't think any of us in this room forget. Sure. It's just so incredibly personal. And for her to have realized that at this really critical time, when she's really actually grown up not, like, you know, being someone who isn't taught to, like, she's her instinct is not to, like, speak up against her father or to to go against him in any way. And so what happens when suddenly, like, you know, she's always very proudly stood behind him, very quietly supporting, and what happens when now maybe she can finally find her voice and it's not aligned with his? So it was one of those things that you don't, like Lilian was saying earlier, like, you start out thinking you're writing one thing and then it just becomes something else. And I loved that about this. Like, I love that about writing, period, right? But I loved that especially about this book, because I think that that it's something that so many of us can relate to. And it really became to me a book about, like, holding people to account for their power and what they choose to do with it. And that's not even only about her, like, Maddie's father, as, you know, as someone who's running for president, but even about Maddie herself. Like, she's so afraid to speak up at first that she doesn't think she has power. So when she realizes she does, what's she going to do with it? So really, for me, that was, that ended up being, like, the heart of the book. I was surprised that it actually ended up being a lot of fun for me to write. And that's not to say that that writing isn't fun. Obviously, I don't think any of us would do this if we didn't love it truly, right? But sometimes writing, for me at least, there's times when writing is hard and necessary, and it's like an excavation, and it's, it's all these things that maybe my previous books were, but this one for me was just like a lot more of a joyous experience. And I think it was just because so much of it had to do with Maddie, and I just kind of fell in love with her. And I felt like really proud of her journey by the end of it, even though it's not a perfect one. And I think it's just because, you know, I related a lot to her, to what she was going through.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. I think even at my age, I felt like I was learning a lot from Maddie, specifically just how to deal with the fact that your parents aren't always right, and to question them and to be in a space where you're like, wow, like, this person that, and, you know, as a mother now, it's kind of strange to be like, someday I'm going to be wrong, and I hope my kid can find their voice to be like, hey, you know, you're wrong. Yeah. So I love that about being able to read your book, and so congratulations. I want to open it up to audience Q&A. I just have two more group questions. They should be kind of fun and short. So I'm during this time, feel free to throw your questions into the Q&A box or in the chat. I believe we'll be able to get to them in there too. But okay, so here's my question. So this question is fully inspired by Lilian Rivera and her love for Bad Bunny, El Conejo Malo, which I also love, and really like music period. If you read her book, in like literally the first 3 or 4 pages, it's just like so many references to be like perfect songs. Like it needs to be a playlist. But I want to ask all of you, like, if your book, if you could just like select one song that would capture the essence of your book, like what would it be? And I will start with Angie, and I have the power to unmute now, so. Oh.
Yes. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, you know, the first song that comes up in my book is Bésame Mucho.
I know, and you sing it. Can you sing a little bit of it?
Oh my God, no.
Okay, next time.
Okay, if you want me to.
You twisted my arm.
But anyway, so most of you know the song, right? Is Bésame, bésame mucho, como si fuera esta noche. Anyway, la última vez, blah, 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 blah. Anyway, and that song was written by Consuelo Velázquez in the 40s, and she had never been kissed. So the tension between writing this song about kiss me, kiss me, kiss me, and being afraid to lose something, I think does embody a lot of the themes in the book, right? Of innocence, but also loss, of desire. So I would say Bésame Mucho.
I love it. And I'll jot these down so that we can do a playlist later for the Grand Combo Tour. All right, how about you, Melissa?
Okay, sorry. You know, I thought about this question a lot and I couldn't think of one song that really, I just imagine there's a scene in the book where they're like celebrating New Year, and I always hear the same song like in their living room, and that is Rebelión by Joe Arroyo.
Mm.
So I would say that song. Oh, I don't know if it's the entire book, but that's the song that I hear at their party.
No, that's perfect. How about Shakira?
Oh, I was just thinking about this because my book is so different from one section to the other. It opens with Missy Elliott's Work It in the prologue before the chapters start. And I feel like that song works for the chapters that are about me and my friends. But really when I think of my life as a whole, and when I think of my early childhood and my time with my family, I really think of Ismael Rivera's Las Caras Lindas, which starts, it's like a celebration of Blackness and Black people and all different kinds of Black people. And he's talking about what it means to sing for your people and to your people in celebration of Blackness and joy. And so that, for me, is the song. I was not gonna sing it. I am happy to play it for you. You'll never see me sing in public. So
I know when Angie did a reading, I think she had come to that part and she was doing a reading in the bookstore and she just sang it, and I was like, what, you sing? Okay.
I don't sing.
You sing. I think, I mean, yeah, that's singing for me. Carolina.
I'm unmuted, right?
Yep.
Tú no puedes comprar el viento, tú no puedes comprar el sol, tú no puedes comprar la lluvia, tú no puedes comprar el calor. So that
is Latinoamérica by Calle 13 with the incomparable Susana Vaca singing also as a guest. And that, it's like, it's not a song that my characters would have known, but in terms of process, it's one of my personal anthems that I have on like my personal playlist to like get me in there to write. And it's such a liberation, Latinidad, Latino America song. When I feel down, I'm like, let's do this. Tú no puedes comprar el viento. It's ours. It's liberation. It's love. It's living radiantly even when the world wants to freaking erase you. And it gets me in there.
I love it. So, I mean, karaoke, I think you and Angie would do this like magically. Don't ask me to sing. I can't. Lilium, I feel like it's going to be a Bad Bunny song. I hope it is.
I'll mute myself. Yes. Hey. Yeah, it would be weird if I didn't have a Bad Bunny song. And oh my God, I'm not going to sing it, but I sing it in my head every single day. And it's got to be the Fe fucking Ere song. That's the Puerto Rican anthem. I mean, I listened to this album when it first came out, and I just felt like we were all on Twitter just going off on all the songs. And I was like, this was the Puerto Rican anthem. This is the summer song that I'm going to be playing every day, every day, every day. So, fucking, sorry I cursed, but that's, you know, that's the Bad Bunny way.
No, I love it. I love it. And I mean, that album, we could talk about it. Me, you, and Melissa could just like have a like listening party and like, we would be set, right?
All day, all night.
Natalia.
Okay. So there's this song. Do y'all know Ella by Bebe? So the song like means a lot to me because I don't know, I kind of tear up every time I hear it because I feel like there's this person in my life who I love very much who was going through a really rough time when they got divorced. And I think of it like kind of as her anthem because it's like, it starts out like, ella se cansado de tirar la toalla, you know, and it's like, it's all about like, this is her day, you know? And I'm very like protective of Maddie in that same way. Like, I know I'm old enough to be Maddie's mom, but I really think of her more as like a friend. And there's this line in that song that says, hoy vas a ser la mujer que te dé la gana de ser. You know, so it's like you get to be the woman that you, like whatever the fuck you want today, like that's you get to be the person you want to be. And I love that. I love that that's, you know, that's her journey. And that's what I hope for any person that reads this book to kind of embrace that. So.
Wow, I love it. So my last question, and it's just like really just I want to close by thanking Mi Mundos, by thinking the Lip Bar, by thinking Word Up, and really you guys for writing. I think as a queer Latina immigrant, I just feel immensely grateful to have found your words because they help me find the language to define and process and express my own experiences. And so with that in mind, I wonder what books or people or things have helped you find that language to motivate you to write about your own experiences. And we can start with Angie.
Good. what book motivated me to write? I think that the books that got me really thinking about being a writer, I guess, were African-American writers like Toni Morrison and James Baldwin and slave narratives that I was reading in undergrad. I think that was the beginning of my journey as a writer. I would say the one that made me believe I could actually write a book was How the Garcia Girls Lost Their Accents by Julia Alvarez, because it's the first book I bought. And when I saw that she was Dominicana, I mean, she was the first Latina that I had seen in print. So for me, that was really empowering too.
Wow. How about you, Carolina?
There's so many. Toni Morrison was one of mine. There's so many along the way, but I'll just pick one. The first queer Latina writer I ever read was Sheree Moraga, Latina writer. It was Loving in the Warriors. And I was lucky enough that it was assigned to in college. And it was the same year I came out. I was 19. And it just, it blew my mind, and it allowed me to be inside my skin in ways that I hadn't been able to before. And even though there's differences in her and my experiences, there was so much resonance. And it was an incredibly important book for me. It helped me exist on a level that I didn't know I could in the world as a person and then as a writer.
I recently read her memoir that she wrote about motherhood.
Yes, yes.
That was really eye-opening. How about you, Natalia?
Okay, let's see. I would say the first one that I have to think about or that comes to mind for me is Eduardo Galeano's The Book of Embraces, because I read it when I was in 11th grade. And I'll be honest, at the time, I was really just more entranced by the language. Looking back, I realized that I read it at a time where I hadn't quite, you know, fully realized my own politics as a young person. And the way he wove in the personal and the political and like the magical and surreal and the real, and it's just like, just absolutely has come to over time have like very different meaning. And but also it's really hard to even just pick one, you know. And I think you had originally asked us too, like, aside from books, what are some of the things that empower us? And for me, it's really just this community. Like, mm-hmm. I feel like each one of you is just so incredibly, at least from where I'm standing, right? Like, just, you seem so completely fearless and fierce and wonderful and brave to me. And I know that, like, oftentimes that doesn't mean we are without fear. But it means that we keep going, right? And so when I feel fear and when I feel hesitant, I look often to you all and I think, like, what would they do? And that's where I pull strength from, and that's where I pull any sense of courage from. And that's what makes me feel empowered to tell my stories. So really, it's all about you all, and even just the community at large that we've all found, you know, through online and through just being part of this, like, just as being authors and writers. It's just incredible, and I feel very, like, blessed to be a part of it.
I love it. How about Jakira?
Thank you. I don't know how I can say anything after that. it does feel like a great time to be a writer now. It feels like I look around the room and I'm like, there's so many of us now. I never imagined that there would be. When I found the first book I read in English about Puerto Ricans was Esmeralda Santiago's When I Was Puerto Rican. And I had this feeling of being seen, but also it was like an awakening for me. I thought, holy shit, we exist. Mm. When so many books that were handed to me before then by librarians were books by and about white people, and occasionally I'd, you know, get a book written by a Black woman and I'd feel like, wait a minute, you can be a Black woman and be a writer? And then Esmeralda Santiago kind of woke me up, and I realized we can write about people like us. We can, and I will. But after that, I still felt sort of a disconnect with that memoir in a way, because it felt like it represented a certain kind of experience, but not necessarily mine. It gave me hope that we could write about people like me, but I also still felt like I was a bad girl, right? And there were all these other things that I wanted to write about, not just being a good girl, but being someone who misbehaved and who disrespected her parents and who navigated the world in a very different way. And so finding the work, like being alive now and reading now and finding work by women who are so different, who come from different backgrounds, who are queer, I feel like I wish I was a teenager now.
Yeah. No, I completely agree. I mean, I'm like, but you know, it's nice to like be able to kind of heal that little person inside of you by reading young adult. Yeah. So I love that. How about you, Melissa?
I think the first book where I actually felt like a real connection to was probably Isabel Allende's House of the Spirits, mm-hmm. only because it felt very much like a story that my father would tell me, you know, like the kind of story my father would tell me, the way he would recount things in his past or his childhood. But I, you know, after he passed away, I really felt like I guess needed to find a way to maybe tell his story and my parents' stories and the stories of people like them, like me. Mm-hmm. And so that, honestly, that was really what sort of led me to writing, to taking it seriously. It's kind of a way of staying close to my family and my ancestors and my community.
Thank you. Lilian?
Did I unmute myself? Yeah. I'm good, right?
Yeah, you're good.
Yeah, I had the same experience like Shakira. It was Esmeralda Santiago was my pick as well. But I also wanted to say a poet. I want to mention Julia de Burgos, a Puerto Rican poet, and she's the one that I turn to every time I'm feeling kind of lost. I just open up the book that I have of hers by my bedside and I read it. And there's one poem that I've been just reading over and over again, and it's I'm not going to read it, but I just wanted to read this one verse. It's the title is Yo Fui La Más Callada. Mm-hmm. And this one thing she says, yo fui la más callada, la que saltó la tierra sin más arma que un verso. And I see that, I read that over and over, like, that's all you need. I was armed only with a verse. And I'm just like, if I can't get inspiration from that, I don't know what I'm doing. So Julia de Burgos is my pick.
Yeah, I was lucky to be introduced to her when I took a Spanish lit class in high school for native speakers, which was like strange, but I'm glad it was there. So I'm going to pivot to the Q&A questions. So Maria Sanchez asked, as a Latina, it breaks my heart to read these stories of women sometimes. In the case of Dominicana, I think of my mother and aunts going through that similar immigrant wife story. Do you feel pain for your sisters, ancestors when writing these stories? And if so, how do you move through that? And I think we can start with Angie first.
You know, I find writing, I don't feel pain when I'm writing. I think I feel a lot of empathy for the experiences that I hear and have witnessed and have experienced myself, right? Like, I'm a survivor of all kinds of abuse, I feel like. And I've witnessed many women in my life have to deal with a lot of different awful, challenging situations. But when I'm writing, I actually feel like it's the freest, safest space I could possibly be in, right? Because in that space, no one is telling me what to do. No one is telling me how to do it. And I also feel like empowered in some ways. Like, if I'm able to write, I'm in a space of power. So the way I move through it is actually through the writing, right? And I learned very much later on how writing is a way to help anxiety. That it's one of the therapies in cognitive therapy. They tell people to write, right? And I was like, oh, maybe that's why when I'm writing, I feel so grounded. Because if I'm able to write, which is not always true, there are lots of, you know, people think that I'm not the kind of writer that writes every day. I hate, you know, if there are any writers here who've been told they have to write every day to be a writer, I'm not that writer, you know. But when I am writing, I feel like usually in those moments, even if I'm not grounded when I start, by the time I end, something powerful is happening inside of me. Like, you know, even if the writing is bad, I still can feel the ground in a way. So it's not pain. It's always more like I'm moving through these stories as a privilege, you know? I feel privileged that I have the possibility to use language, you know, and yeah.
Yeah, does any of the panel, any of the authors have anything to add? I mean, feel free to unmute yourself. I see you're all muted. If not, we can move to the next question. All right, so let's see, the next question is, for those of you who write YA and middle grade, how do you put yourselves in the mind of your young characters? So this is for Natalia and Lilian.
Okay, so how do I do that? I don't know. I'm always in angst, aren't you? I'm always depressed and full of anger and raging and rebelling, and it's like 24/7. So I don't know. I like to write about that age. I when I'm writing middle grade, it's totally different. So that was a challenge for me this year. But when I write for young adults, I try to just think about that age, like what it was like. And although my characters are not like me at all, you know, but they're all like me. You know, I really do believe that they're all parts of me, you know, from the parents all the way to, you know, the monster, you know. So they're all parts of me that I'm trying to tackle or excavate or what have you. So yeah, that's really, I just really try to think about what that age is like, and also think about, I know this may sound really technical, but just really think about that age range, because middle grade and YA is a totally different world, and you're looking at the world in very different view, you know, different eyes. So I really have to look at that and read psychology and read all these other things that you would never think about reading when it comes to writing young adult and middle grade.
Yeah, I agree. I think one of the things I was surprised, well, first, because when I started writing Running, I didn't know I was writing YA. Like, I sent the first 75 pages to my agent, and she said, oh, you know you're writing YA. And I thought, that makes sense, because I'm not really writing this book for the adults in the book. You know, I'm writing to someone like Maddie. I'm writing, and not only that, but like, my reading life was mostly YA. I read very widely, but really I remember that time in my life, like the places that were bringing, like that were filling me up were YA books. And so I think Lilian, you said this one time and it stuck with me so much. You said that that so much of YA is about writing like the firsts. And I just loved that. I think that, like, for me, it's this active process of not forgetting what it was like, and to honor that, like, to really, because we, you know, knowing what we know now, can we look back and still not minimize it? You know, I think there's nothing worse than having someone tell you, like, oh, one day this is not, none of this is going to matter, and you're going to realize you have such bigger problems. And it's like, no, when you're any age, you know, every little thing, if it matters to you, then it's big. You know, and it affects young kids have this, there's this constant struggle between, you know, how much power do they have versus like, hey, they actually do have a lot of power, but then they don't, like in terms of just by virtue of, like, what if you're not driving yet? What if you're not old? You know, like all these things. And so there's this, like, I guess I really try really hard to get to go back there. I sometimes cheat. Honestly, I have journals. Like, I've had journals since I was 9. And so I often will reread my journals. Like, it's kind of nice that I, like, my hoarder tendencies really have paid off, because I have like boxes full of notes that my boyfriend and I, like when I was in 10th, 11th grade, wrote to one another. And so it really takes me back there, and I can remember, like, oh my God, like, we really, like, that, like, this was the world, and that's okay, because that's how we became who we are today, right? And so I just, And I'm also really obsessed with memory. So for me, I just love that YA is, for me, this like active process of, you know, remember and honor and hold space for that.
So our next question is just for Melissa. Can you repeat your song choice for your book?
Oh, yeah. Rebellion.
Awesome.
Joe Arroyo.
And so, okay, we have one that says, yes, Malo Conejo, but also most anticipated 2020 book that you want to read. And I guess this is for everyone. We can start with Angie.
I just read a book that I'm really excited to see out in the world by a Haitian writer, Haitian American Canadian writer, Miriam Chomsky. It's called Deuce.
Ooh.
And it's, like right when the hurricane, the earthquake happened in Haiti. And it's so beautifully written. So I'm really excited about that book. And it's coming out with HarperCollins. So.
Oh. How about Natalia?
Oh my God. I have so many, but how am I never prepared for this question, even though I know? Oh God. So I have Lilium's book. And I'm going to read it.
It's good. It's really good.
I'm so excited. And it's like, I know, like, I've kind of just turned this into, like, a fan girl fest for Liam. But but no, it's just, like, I love all your books. So this, like, for me, is just such a treat to have another one coming.
But no lie, Lilium's book, I started reading it, and I was like, oh, let me check out this song. And suddenly, I was having a party and reading the book. It's perfect for this moment.
William, are you planning to have like a playlist with the book later when it comes out? Awesome.
Hold on. Sorry. Yes. I do playlists. Usually I have a playlist for Dealing in Dreams and The Education of Margot Sanchez. It's on Spotify. And so I do have one for Never Look Back, Sofia Sanyudi. It's heavy on bachata and Prince, as it should be. should I just add my...
Yeah, I was just going to say, okay. Go ahead and add your book.
Yes. So I just got this arc and it's new. It's a Puerto Rican writer. Her book is called Blaze Rap Game and it's Amparo. And I want to say her last name, is it Ortiz? I just want to make sure, but her name is Amparo. Yes, Amparo Ortiz and it's Blaze Rap Games and it's set in Puerto Rico and there's dinosaurs. Like they ride dinosaurs, like it's a sport. And I don't know about you guys, but that's amazing. So I'm like ready for it. So I just got it and now I'm excited about it already. So.
Love it. How about you, Jakira?
There are two books that I want to read that I just got. The first one is Fiebre Tropical by Juliana Delgado Lopera.
It's so good. It's so good.
Ah, yay. I'm so glad to hear that. I just got it. And then Hurricane Season. Have you read that? It's a translation.
I got it, but I haven't read it yet, but I'm excited.
I haven't started it yet. And it's a translation of Fernanda Melchor's, which was originally in the Spanish. She's a Mexican author. So I'm very excited for those two books.
Awesome. Carolina?
Oh gosh, I'm so excited. Honestly, I'm really, really excited about Lilium and Natalia's books. I'm just jonesing to get my hands on them. It sounds so exciting. So those are probably my top two that I'm excited about for the rest of 2020. And I'm also excited about Leila Lalami's next book, Conditional Citizen, which is a nonfiction book. And she's, you know, such an incredible fiction writer that I'm excited for this nonfiction take on, you know, the treatment of immigrants and not only Muslim immigrants, but undocumented immigrants and so many different people and people of color in this country in our current times. And it seems like it's also, I gather that it's also a very personal take, not just sort of like bigger political piece. And I feel excited to be nourished by that.
Awesome. I think we just have Melissa left.
Well, I just got Lilium's book too, and I'm reading it you have to understand, like, being here in New York right now, it is really hard to just be in your tiny apartment. For me, with my two children, my husband, I love them, but I really want to leave the house or the apartment and, like, be it with New York, because I love New York. And, like, in, like, the first couple of pages of Liliam's book, like, Fias is complaining about the subway and the MTA, and, like, the train is not running on the weekend. And I'm just, like, I started reading, and I was, like, oh, I miss being able to complain about the freaking train on the weekend and, like, not running. So, I don't know. It's just, it's, like, a nice, it's, like, it's nice. It's, like, a bomb right now. Just because I miss being in this, being in New York City, really being in it so much. So, so yeah, I love it, Liliam, and I'm really excited to finish it.
I really want to echo, everybody should read it. It's really good. I'm reading it now. I'm looking forward to ending this so I can go read it. No, I'm kidding. So our next question is, for so long, Latina voices didn't exist in the US publishing world. I find that now we are working on telling stories not told. To what degree do you feel you are telling the story not told? How does that influence your narrative? And let's start with Carolina.
Thank you for that great question. I mean, I feel like I'm constantly telling stories not told. And certainly, I mean, that's what I said about finding Sri Muraga's book in the mid 90s. It was like, oh, this can exist on the page, you know, let alone in the world. It's this like large inside and complex, rich, nuanced queer Latina voice. And now we are in this time where we do have Fiebre Tropical coming out, and like just so many different voices and such a big range of stories and perspectives that have yet to fill the space. And I think my first novel came out in 2009. And at that time, you know, I feel like Latina literature, and Angie has also been publishing for a really long time. Liliam, I know there's other people who've had this experience of like, you know, things were put in a box, and there was, and the box was very small and kind of reductive. And now with so many different voices, it's just, it's so refreshing to even be on a panel with six different people where we can all be talking about this, the enormous range and complexity and beauty of the stories that we're telling is just evidence of it. So I do feel like I'm telling stories that haven't been told. I've never seen a novel in any language, in English or Spanish, that centers five very different queer women in a Latin American country and then follows them for 35 years and really looks at how queerness affects their lives and how they live and love. So I wrote into being something that needed to happen. But that's just the beginning. It's only one, you know? So we still need so much more and more story. And there's story that only this one or this one or this one can possibly tell and allow to move through them. And that's what's so beautiful about having a lot of richness.
Yes. How about Melissa?
Yeah, you know, I don't know if I think about whether or not someone has told the story before. Mm-hmm. I just write the story that I feel like this character is trying to force me to tell about them, you know? Obviously, like, my subconscious is, like, telling me, like, to tell something, to tell this story, you know what I mean? It's, like, motivated by, I think, my own experience and my family's experience and, again, like whatever it is that I'm sort of trying to explore and excavate. But I guess in most of the spaces that I've occupied, and I think that most of us have occupied, we've been sort of like the minority, right? Like we are like the folks who are not, I mean, I work at a company where like there are 100 people in my office and I'm like one of two Latinas, you know, and then like, and that's it. So it feels like, whenever any story that I'm going to tell will naturally feel like it's something that hasn't been, for me at least, it feels like I don't know if I've ever read it before or seen it before. But I can't say that I actually write to sort of like give voice to anything in particular. except for the character that I feel very strongly, that I feel very strongly is trying to tell me something. And I can only trace that back to my own intuition.
Thank you. Jakira?
So yes and no. One of the things that I thought about a lot while writing my first book is something that came up again after it was published when I had my girls who were in the book come to my launch party in Miami. And they had been hearing some of this, they had been hearing me read from the book for the very first time. They all knew about the book. They all came to the release party. But afterwards we went to dinner and one of my girls said to me that she was proud, that she felt that validated, that it was uplifting to see herself in a book. But also she said, people don't write books about people like us. Nobody's writing books about people like us. And I wanted to say, yes, we do. We've been working, we've been writing, they just haven't been publishing them. Mm-hmm. But I also understood that feeling of not seeing yourself in a book, not feeling like the world sees you, like you don't exist, and then discovering yourself in a book for the first time. I often think about that. And one of the things that made me a writer, it's one of the reasons why I'm working, well, I'll always be writing, for my community.
Thank you. Natalia?
Yeah, I totally agree, Shakira, because I think someone, like Carolina was saying, like my first book came out in 2014, and I remember it's set in Peru, and I remember a comment I got so often from white readers was, I love learning about other cultures. It just stayed with me so much because I was like, I didn't write this for you. Like, I didn't write this for my life and my family and, you know, my lived experience to be somebody's anthropology lesson, you know, to be put under this lens as if we're just so exotic and interesting only by virtue of being other, you know, of being defined that way through their eyes. And so I really, I don't know if I think so much consciously in terms of when I write stories, like, is this a story that's not been told? But I do think a lot about who I'm writing it for. And I hope, I think of my characters as real people because they are, you know, at least like they're real people who are living in this world with a lot of different challenges. And I think of them as having boundaries and I try to respect that in the work, you know, because I don't think that we owe anyone everything through our stories. You know, we are beholden and loyal to the stories we want to tell and to the stories that we're trying to honor through them, right? So it's just, that's really how I approach that. And I like, to me, that's what, I feel lucky that I feel more empowered to do that lately because I wasn't as aware of it in my first book. I look back and I'm like, oh my God, the Spanish is italicized. Ugh. but this has been an evolution and I just feel lucky that over time, like I felt empowered to really question that and then very like hopefully, you know, be more proactive in that and really kind of protecting the stories as we uplift them.
Thank you. Lillian?
Yeah, just quickly. I guess for me, it's just a matter of being able to just write whatever I want, you know, and having those bookshelves really just prevalent of all types of stories. So it doesn't have to be about brown or black pain, but it could also be about just joy and silliness. And, you know, and that's why I love Goldie Vance, the Hotel Dennett, because it's totally positive and she wants to be, you know, she just wants to solve mysteries. And yes, why can't we have that too? And so then I just want that. I just want bookshelves of options because that's all I wanted when I was looking for stories. I just wanted one. And now we have some. And now I just want a lot more. I just want all of it, you know? So it's just options for all our, for everyone to be able to just read all types of different stories.
I completely agree, 100%. Angie?
Well, yeah, everyone's basically said everything I could possibly say. I mean, I think that I am really excited that there are so many more books out there, but it's not enough. I feel like I go into a bookstore, and because the book cycle in a bookstore is so short, it's very easy to go into any bookstore and only see one Latinx book in any particular book cycle. But because our community is so desperate, our books have a longevity that other books might not have and visibility for a longer amount of time. But the reality is that our numbers are still incredibly low. So, and there's definitely an underrepresentation of Central American and Afro-Latinx stories in publishing, which is like such a huge problem too, right? So I'm excited and I'm optimistic that there's a change. There's a possible turn in and or opening in Latinx voices. And I'm excited that I even have all of you that we're more than we were before. Definitely when I came out with Soledad, the community was tiny, tiny, tiny. But I do think that this is the moment, especially, you know, unfortunately, what weights economically in this country and all these things, we're going to have to be really careful how we spend our money. And I feel like if we're going to spend our money on books, we really should vote with our money, what kind of books we want in the bookstores. And we could borrow the other books from the library or like from the free lending libraries. But like, if we're going to spend our money, I think we really need to start investing in Latinx literature. We want to see it out there because the numbers are still incredibly low. I don't know the percentages, but they're very, very low. And if you think about New York City and the big cities that are cultural producers, like, it's devastating to me. So yeah, like when I think about writing stories that haven't been told, so many haven't been told. I could think of a million stories that I want to write that I have not seen in any kind of mainstream film or movie or TV or book. So, and I do think that novels, the reason I'm interested in novels is because they're supposed to be novel, right? You either have to say something new or say it in a way that has never been told before. So, and that's really what I do when I work. I don't think about, oh, I'm telling this story that's never been told. I'm looking for a story that's interesting to me and have the freedom that Lilium has, right? Like, yeah, why not write a story about riding dinosaurs across New York City or wherever? And also to have an industry in a world where people allow us to be as free as the next white boy, right? Like, white boys can write about whatever they want and they get banked for it, you know? But I feel like people are investing in us and want us to write about a particular story, and they kind of like tie us in there, and I want to be free in that way too. So, yeah.
No, thank you. So I'm conscious of the time, and I know we've gone over a little bit, and I just want to thank you all so much for your time and being here with us. I think the DJ will still be spinning, so I know that there's so many questions that we didn't get to in the Q&A, so if you guys want to look through them, I know that some of them are specific to your books. If you want to look through them and answer them, you're welcome to. If not, I think if you want to just close, like, how are you, we got this question in the Q&A, how are you taking care of yourself during this time? And we can just close with that. If everybody wants to answer, Jakira.
Yeah, thank you. I feel like that's all I've been doing is working on taking care of myself. For a while, my mom was sick and, So it was a very stressful time. I also had to cancel my wedding, and my partner were having problems with U.S. immigration. So I spent a long time kind of desperate to like take care of my mental health. And so what I've been doing a lot of therapy, more than I usually do, a lot of therapy. And I've been working out and going for walks and calling people every single day, having conversations and meeting up with my friends online, and also like watching ridiculous sci-fi TV shows with friends that have absolutely nothing to do with real life. So basically I've been doing anything and everything to try and just take care of myself. I try to write, I've been writing letters, I've been cooking so much, cooking everything from scratch, everything. And what else? I've cleaned this apartment more than I've cleaned like the whole year that I've lived here in the pandemic. I'm like, that's like every other day I'm cleaning. So I'm exhausted, but also now for the first time, like I feel hopeful. I feel like this is gonna end, and I have hope that like no matter what happens, I'm gonna be able to deal with it. It's been helpful to have people that I can call in the middle of the night and say, like, today was a really hard day, I can't sleep. So I feel like now when I start to feel better is when I need to be there for my people, right? To be there for my friends, to be the person they call. So I'm focusing now on being grateful and being there for other people like they were for me.
Angie?
Well, I did this. You know, I feel like we're in a space where we feel powerless and kind of like, what are we gonna do? And I feel like what I'm thinking a lot is, what are my spheres of influence, right? Where can I influence? And one of the things I learned, and this I learned from my mother, is that, you know what, we are responsible for our community. It's part of our home. Our home doesn't end the moment that we close the door of our apartment. And, you know, Word Up is part of my community. And I know that you know, if there's a way that I could help, like I wanted to help, but also it's not that hard to connect with other people, but there is that thing, right? Like where I feel like it was so easy to connect with all these women in this imagining of the Gran Combo. And it's been incredibly healing because I feel like when there's mutual desire for connection, anything can happen,
yeah.
Right? When there's openness and generosity and mutual desire, anything can happen. So for me, that's really been part of, like I've been moving toward those spaces where there's mutual desire, not those spaces that resist me, right? There's too many spaces that resist me. So I'm moving away from those spaces and moving into the spaces that are, that the fire is hot. You know, and I feel like this is one of those spaces for me. So I'm really excited about this event. I'm really excited for all the people that supported this event.
No, I see Noelle of it, like giving kisses, and I'm like, yeah. No, I'm so excited for this too. And honestly, like, it's been such a like delight on my end to be able to talk to you guys. Melissa?
I'm muted. Okay. I'm sorry. They should be in bed. I think that my husband lost control of them. So self-care. Yeah. And
I love it. Honestly, I love it so much.
I took a bath once since we've been in quarantine. I mean, I showered, sorry. But like, I took like a bath of like a few weeks ago. That was really great. And that was my first attempt at self-care during quarantine. I will probably do it again tomorrow. So that's self-care.
Thank you. Carolina.
So one thing that's been getting me through actually has been putting on music. There's like so many dishes to do. I have two kids. My elder mother-in-law is with us. My wife, it's all very full, but like the music can accompany you. So I'm actually going to fulfill Lizette Norman's request that I end with another song.
Yay!
I say for all of you. Tanto tiempo disfrutamos, nuestro amor, nuestras almas se acercaron, tanto así que yo guardo tu sabor, y tú llevarás también sabor a mí.
I love it. Okay, we have to do karaoke after this. All of us, it's a must. Like, we gotta do it. Lilian.
I love that I follow after Carolina's singing. It's just hard. I can't compete. the only thing that's getting me through is really dancing. It's just Debbie Allen, D Nice, all these DJ battles on Instagram. I'm just like living my life. I'm so happy that I get to witness this online with everyone else. It's like, and dancing. That's the only thing, because I know I could connect with someone. I'm only like, oh, you doing this? Are we listening to this DJ right now? Yes. All right. You dancing in your kitchen? So am I. So this is the only way I could get through this, is really through dancing.
Yeah, no, we did the same thing. We tuned into D Nice, it was like a couple of weekends ago, and it was awesome. We did it in the basement. The kid was asleep. We like, it was a whole party. Natalia.
I've been baking. Oh my god, that's like my love language. So I made like alfajores a couple nights ago. I made my mom's cheesecake recipe yesterday. Making just cookies and muffins and whatever, and then sometimes I'll drop them off at friends' houses and just kind of leave them at the door because I can't actually eat all of it. I mean, I eat a lot of it, but also like these are big recipes and I'd rather make more. But also I think in general, like, I've been writing some days and then other days I don't, you know, and then some days I find I've been trying to do the things that, like, you know, like when you have, like, at the end of the day, you're like, I'm glad I did that one thing because that made it a good day. Mm-hmm. So I'm trying to just do that thing first thing in the morning. Sometimes that's writing. Sometimes it's like going and getting like some, like a workout in or whatever, you know. Maybe it's like reading, like actually sitting down to read. I started building a puzzle, which just like, I used to do that with my grandmother when I was little. And every time I put a little piece in, I hear her laughter, you know? And so it's just, I'm trying to surround myself with things that just bring comfort and, you know, being honest with myself and like, what do I need today? If I can figure that out. Sometimes you don't figure it out and that's okay too.
Yeah. But I think I got to everybody. I kind of lost track. but I just want to say thank you to Philip Barr, to Mil Mundos, to Angie, to Word Up for all the tech stuff. I know it was a little bit challenging. I hope everyone had a good time. Like I said, I think the DJ is going to be spinning. So if people want to hang out and just like listen to him spin, do it. And then again, thank you everybody for being here and for coming and for the honor.
Thank you.
You did a great job. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for everyone, to everyone for coming. And I'm gonna unmute. Are you, if Sarita or Noelle want to say anything?
Thank you so much for coming to this Word Up / Lip Bar / Mil Mundos. Mil Mundos production. Thank you to all of the authors. My heart is full, and the best part is I don't have to clean up the store after this.
But she will in the future, because we're coming there.
Normal I can get used to, and I can't wait to see you guys all in person at the other side of this. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Bessel, hugs. Lupita, you killed it. You killed it. Oh my God.
Absolutely.
Are we taking a picture? How are we doing this?
Oh yeah, make sure I'm ready.
Come on. Someone's
all right, hang on.
Do we do a...
Where did you go?
All right, one, two, and everybody cheese.
Let me a screenshot of everybody. So everybody just look straight into your camera and smile. Perfect. Oh, you look great.
Thank you guys. This is wonderful. Thank you so much for everything that you do.
Thank you. Thank you, Lupita. Thank you for setting this up. And thank all of you, Word Up and Mil Mundos and the Lip Bar. I'm so happy. This really made my week.
Thank you, Angie. And thank you to all the attendees too, everyone who is listening and who's been watching and who's been requesting, you know, more singing from everybody. we'll try and put everything together into a, you know, a wrap up post with everyone's book lists and links to, so you can read the stuff, and to Spotify playlists. And let us know if you have any feedback on stuff, you know, and what else you want to see from all of us, from all the authors, and also from all the bookstores while we're in this new time and place for programming. We're happy to do more stuff like this and to do other things. Maybe that time for that karaoke.
Oh God, I'm not singing.
Because if the mics hadn't been all muted, I would have told you all to sing along.
Shakira, you and me both. My wife is texting me like, sing, you need to sing. It's
Are you serious?
I was
okay,
like, I don't sing.
Okay, so next time. So we really do have a karaoke next time.
Next time I will practice and I will try to sound a little bit like Angie. And you, I mean, Carolina, I just don't. I don't
practice. I'm just not afraid to be goofy, you know? Because
I have to say, I don't sing. But there's a question that someone asked about, I guess, inspiration or writing. And I actually started to sing because I almost quit writing. And in the process, yeah, I was devastated. I had been rejected like 100 million times and nobody wanted to buy the book. And I was in some residency in Florida by myself, and my friend sent me a video doing karaoke. And I was so jealous because I said, what am I doing? The life of a writer sucks. Yeah. Here by myself writing and they're out dancing and singing. And I realized I had never done karaoke. And I said, why haven't I done karaoke? And I was like, because I can't sing. Here I am talking to myself because I'm all by myself. And I was like, who made me think I couldn't sing? So I went online and I took all these tests about my vocal range and my tone. And it told me that I was a great singer. And I thought, I'm going to take classes from this dude on YouTube who's going to teach me how to sing by the end of the day. So I took like 10 of his classes and I learned how to open my diaphragm and do all the lip curls, and I kept taping myself. And I was like, maybe I could sing. And that's when I realized that the reason my book wasn't working was because my villain needed a gift. And I made him a singer. I
that's
said,
great.
You cannot hate a beautiful singer. It's really hard. Even if you're asking, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Mm. It makes it harder, raises the stakes.
It raises the stakes. So it's not that I could sing, but I think like you say, Carolina, it's like, you know, like, why not? Like, why not put ourselves in a space? Like, who tells us we can't do something, right? You know, like, we could try, like, learning a new language.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You're not perfect, but you're trying to connect. So that's what matters.
You sing. So let's talk more sing.
Yeah. Request for singing in the chat, Angie.
Yeah, your singing was so beautiful.
Yeah. I know, the internet told me. I'm verified.
YouTube verified.
Yes.
I feel like I need to take that course.
Yeah.
Put it in the chat.
Yeah, put it in the chat. I need it too. I mean, I will sing for you guys if I can not be afraid. I will sing.
We can hide our videos.
Well, okay.
You say goodnight? What are we doing?
I don't know. It feels really weird.
Hey, I think it is
time. It's probably time to say goodnight.
Yeah.
You throw on whatever you're
so in. Much love, everybody. Thank
Bye,
you,
everyone.
So much. Thank you, everyone. You are all amazing.
Stay yeah. safe, everyone.
Until
hasta la próxima.
Hasta la próxima.
The DJ, what's up?
Right, DJ. We're waiting.
Date us out, DJ.